I'm really happy you guys are taking this seriously, because I do. Welcome to the show. Today is Sunday, August the 28th, 2016, and our guest today is Philip Fracassi. I'm Mike Davis, the host of the show, and I'm with, I'm the chief. I don't have a fancy title. We'll just call me the chief cook and bottle washer at Lovecraft eZine, and we'll do introductions, and I don't know why you have your mic muted, Mr. Young, since you're going to be doing most of the interviewing. So we'll start with Kelly and go down the line.
I'm Kelly Young. I am the janitor and laboratory cleaner at Strange Eons Magazine.
Finally, honesty.
Everybody needs one.
Matt.
I am Matt Carpenter. I help edit the Lovecraft eZine.
Pete.
Oh, crap.
You don't know who you are?
Yeah. I am Pete Rolick. I am the mop boy at Dagon's Peep Show.
That's really gross.
Well, Salome disappeared just in time for introductions. Her computer must have gotten... She's getting a new one next month, she said. She's having problems. SP.
I'm SP Miskowski, and I write fiction.
Well, then, Philip, why don't you do a brief introduction, and then I think Kelly's going to do most of the interviewing today. Okay. Yeah, I know. I'm sorry.
That's all right. Philip Fracassi. I'm a screenwriter and a author, and that's me. That's what I'm up to.
Is that why we're interviewing you today, or is there something else?
I think that's why you're interviewing me.
Okay.
I have a couple announcements, but I don't want to... I could bring them all up front, or I could front pile it.
I don't know. Let's make people wait. I've read somewhere we should build the suspense.
Yeah, word for our commercial. You don't have commercial breaks, but you want to definitely keep them guessing.
Yeah. I guess before we get to Kelly, you got a prize or two, right, Matt? You said.
Oh, I got a terrific prize, an absolutely great one.
I bet.
This is from the guy, anonymous donor, who wanted these things to find nice homes. This is a copy, hardcover copy of the comic book Dagon.
Oh, man, that is so cool.
And it is.
It does look cool.
And the adapter is Ben.
SP already won one retroactively. Look at that.
I'm a winner!
Absolutely beautiful book. So, really great.
Yeah, that's Ben Temple Smith, who did the series with Steve Niles.
Mm. You can improve your chances by sending small donations.
I'm pretty sure that's illegal, but I'm no lawyer.
How small?
Just write one of your Uncle Ben, you know?
Did you say there was one of those or two of those?
I've got one. I've got one that I'm keeping. This is the one that I'm giving away.
Nice.
There's a neat little, I'm not sure what you would call it, piece of trivia there on that Dagon book, because if you look closely, at least on the one I have, Ben Temple Smith's name is spelled incorrectly on the cover, which has to just kill him.
Nice.
Salome, are you back? I'll go with no on that. There she is. Are you back, Salome?
Back.
Okay, you want to do it? We did. You left just in time to introduce yourself really quickly.
I'm Salome Jones. I'm an editor at Ghostwoods Books.
All right, now everyone can lean back, take it easy, because Kelly Young is driving the bus. Actually, probably put your seatbelts on and kiss your ass goodbye.
I want to know how many drinks Kelly has had first.
I always start with one loaded, and then I go through about four more during the course of the interview. So
that explains a lot, really.
Hi, Philip. Kelly Young, executive editor of Strange Eons Magazine.
Hey, Kelly.
Loaded again.
It's sort of I'm one word now.
I'm really happy that I got the chance to do this because I fell in love with your book Alter, and the weird thing was that I picked it up because I think that we were Facebook friends or something, and I loved the cover. I read it and it was really disturbing, and I pointed it out to my business partner in the magazine. I was like, "Have you ever heard of this Philip Fracassi cat?" And he goes, "Yeah, he buys every issue of the magazine."
Yeah.
I was like, "Oh, holy shit. How come we haven't printed him?"
It's a nice magazine.
Well, I appreciate you saying that.
Very well produced.
Well, so recently you were kind of at the center of a little bit of turmoil, and I don't really want to get into that, but I want to bring it up just because a couple of the people involved were upset and even kind of intimated that you wouldn't be able to be taken seriously because you had not only self-published your work, but then had gone with a very small press. And the real humor in that is that you're already much further along than most of the people who were critiquing you for that.
Possibly. Yeah, I think there's definitely some assumption going on with some of the folks as to, you know, where I'd come from and what stage I was at as a writer, for sure. But regardless, it was not a lot of fun, you know, no matter what.
Right. So I kind of want to then go back to maybe not the beginning, but where you've been working in Hollywood for a number of years, and it looks to me like you started out in the art department on some movies that I really love, and in fact were the assistant director of the Christopher Walken movie, The Prophecy, which yeah. I really dig. And I know from working on film sets that means you get to scream quiet on the set and everybody hates you. Well, I'm curious how you got started in that, and explain to people what art department means, which some of your other credits for, like the Power Rangers movie or Dragon, the Bruce Lee story, things like that, some pretty big projects.
And more importantly, did you scream quiet to Christopher Walken?
No, that would be a bad idea. No, to clarify, I was an on-set dresser on The Prophecy, and I was the first ED for the second unit for the additional photography. So first, the AD thing is something that I would do sort of as a secondary role with a much smaller crew. But I worked on The Prophecy. I actually had a really neat moment in that movie. I had a couple. One, which is I had a scene with Christopher Walken. There is a scene in the movie where he is at the side of a grave, and his sycophant, who's slowly deteriorating, is shoveling dirt out of the grave, and you see dirt flying up out of the grave. And when they did the shot that was from outside, so you couldn't see down into the grave itself, they just needed to see the dirt flying up while Christopher was delivering his lines to his sycophant. So the sycophant didn't want to do the heat throwing the dirt when he wasn't on camera, so I did it. So I was in the grave. This is in Arizona, and was digging while Christopher Walken was delivering his dialogue to me as a kind of a stand-in digger. So it was pretty cool for me. It was a neat, kind of a neat Hollywood moment. You don't often get to actually be in the same room with the actors, much less, you know, when they're actually doing the take. So it was kind of cool.
Right. So how did you get involved in this? How do you get into the art department, and what exactly does the art department do?
Oh, well, I moved to L.A. in 91, late 91, and from Detroit originally, lived in Chicago for a bit, and then moved to L.A. To find stardom and fame. I'm still waiting for that to come through 25 years later. But I fell into it. My friend is a producer. Still a friend. He actually produced the movie I just wrote, Girl Missing, which is currently on demand on iTunes and Amazon. But great guy, and he was a friend of a friend of a friend and got me a job on my first movie, which was Maniac Cop 3. And art department basically, you know, is in charge of the sets, the way the sets look, you know, the really that's kind of what they're way the sets look. My job being an on-set guy was to keep the sets maintained, because what happens is if I'm shooting this way, and then I got to turn around and shoot that way, you know, there need all the furniture from that side of the room needs to go to that side of the room, and then all the furniture from that side of the room needs to go to that side of the room, and it all kind of has to be consistent. So basically my job, among other things, was to make sure that wherever they were looking, it looked good, and it looked like it was supposed to look. So there was a continuity to the previous time they saw that part of the room or desert or forest or whatever might be. And in when I was doing it, this is the early 90s, now they everything's digital, but when I was doing it, I had a roll of Polaroids this thick on a belt, and I would write the scene number down, and I would have to look at every Polaroid when they shot a particular scene and make sure that, you know, whatever they were looking at was right. So that's kind of what I did, and I did that for, I don't know, 5 or 6 years. And then I did, you know, I was an AD, I was a camera assistant, I was a PA, I was, you know, I did a lot of little things throughout. And now I'm a location guy. That's what I do as a day job. So I'm a teamster. I find locations, scout locations, permit locations, and make sure that when the crew shows up in a neighborhood or in a grocery store or wherever it is they need to be, whether it's a CAA building or, you know, Taj Mahal, and make sure that everything goes smoothly, make sure that they know where to put the generator, where to run their cables, where to set up their base camp. That's what a location guide does, and that's what I do. That's what I do now.
Right. So am I correct in assuming that you moved, did you say from Detroit?
Yeah.
So from Detroit to Hollywood because you wanted to get into the film industry.
Yeah, I did. I was also in a lot of legal trouble, so it was like very important that I leave the Midwest. So
did you steal a car with Peter Rolick by any chance?
Was this the big announcement?
No. I don't really have a big announcement. I'm just telling your audience that I do, and we're going to hope they don't remember. But I definitely wanted to work in film. I mean, I've always been a writer. I've been a writer since I was in third grade, and I used to write stories and read them to my class, and I wrote a horror novella when I was in seventh grade called The Woods, I think. It was about a monster that lived in the woods by these kids' houses. So, you know, it was all the rage. And I wanted to write, movies. So I came out to Hollywood, and I didn't end up writing any movies, but I did end up working in the business for quite a while, and still do, with intermissions. I worked in the music industry for about 7 years. I owned a bookstore and art gallery for about 7 years, and now I'm back into production.
In what capacity did you work in the music industry?
I worked for House of Blues Entertainment, which is a concert promoter and a venue owner. And they're actually a fairly big company, at least they were when I was working for them. They actually owned Universal Concerts. So we were the second largest concert promoter in North America. My job with them, I was a vice president of production. So I was in charge of, we built studios in each of the venues. I produced DVDs, internet broadcasts, whatever TV shows, whatever House of Blues was doing from the venues. With the artists, that's what I would produce them. So I did a DVD with Psychedelic Furs. I did a DVD with Public Enemy. I produced like 3,000 internet broadcasts. I was actually, and this is going to date me a little bit, but I actually am on record with the Wall Street Journal and other publications as I was the producer of the first ever live music broadcast over the internet. So I have that to my credit. It was
awesome.
Blind Boys of Alabama. Huh?
Oh, wow. Yeah. Blind Boys of Alabama. That's cool. That was the first internet broadcast.
That was the first concert. Yeah, first live concert. And because we were teamed up with Real Networks, who developed the Real Player, which was the initial technology. And ended up doing concerts with, you know, name it, every band in the world. But because anyone who came through any of our venues or any of the Universal venues or any other venues that we had access to, we would go and shoot them, and we'd broadcast it. First we did audio, and then we did video, and, you know, the whole thing. But it was really cool. It was a very cool time. I knew Mark Cuban, who now owns the Dallas Mavericks. He had a company called Broadcast.com at the time. Actually, it was called AudioNet, and then it was called Broadcast.com. But I worked with him, and he's now, you know, he sold his company to Yahoo for $3.5 billion or whatever. So it was an interesting time, and I really enjoyed it. And but it was time to move on after a while.
Your cat. Is it true that you have a cat?
This is my cat.
He gives zero fucks that you are being interviewed live right now.
No. And my poor girlfriend is over there, just had knee surgery, so she can't even help me. She's over there on the couch. So whatever happens, happens. This is live, man. We're going to go with it.
That's right. And that's why we do this show live, because crazy things like that may happen.
Yeah, that's Perry. So yeah. Pain in the rear.
Yeah, I like cats. I have, we'll just say several. So.
Yeah.
Crazy cat man.
Yeah, but that's kind of, that was what I did to House of Blues. For.
Yeah, when I saw that you had, you know, of course, doing research for this, I was looking at your IMDb page and everything, and when I saw that you had done the Psychedelic Furs House of Blues video, I was like, I remember watching that. How weird.
Oh, really? Yeah, that was cool. I mean, the doing those DVDs was neat because, like, and this was back when, you know, the DVD was the big medium, but it was cool because, like, with Public Enemy, for example, you know, we got to do a lot of documentary stuff, so we got to do a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff. We got to go with Chuck D. We went and drove around, you know, his old hood and filmed it and filmed all the studios that he started at and did some cool interview stuff. So it was neat to be able to do a lot of that work with the artist. And so, yeah, it was a neat time. And the internet, you know, was insane because nobody knew what it was. And, you know, there was all this quality control and all this, you know, the record labels were freaking out and managers were freaking out and because they didn't know what we were doing. And was it downloadable? Was it not? Was it radio? Who were you, you know, who's getting paid? And we were just kind of running with it. And it did eventually catch up to us, among, you know, along with everyone else, which is why there's a bit of a burst in the early 90s, but, you know, a little bit of a bubble burst, but because people realized that they actually had to pay for this content. But yeah, so it was a cool time, and it was a fun time to be doing what I did.
Yeah, you were kind of there, you know, when everything was the Wild West. You were sod-busting on the internet.
Yeah, yeah, I worked very, very closely with Real, and I worked very, very closely with Microsoft. We were actually part of their – I worked with them on their number, I think it was their fifth browser launch, whatever it was, IE5. So, yeah, it was neat. I got to work with, you know, I got to be on the cutting edge of some pretty neat stuff that was right at the beginning of really what the internet turned out to be, you know, which is a media platform.
So going back a little bit, you're doing art department work and AD work and stuff like that, but you're obviously writing scripts this entire time.
Yeah.
And, oh, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, writing scripts, writing stories, you know, very, I was really, in which we'll talk a little bit about, I can talk about it now, as really focused on literary fiction. So I wrote, during that time I was at House of Blues and working, owning the bookstore in Venice, I was writing novels. So I wrote like three literary novels. I can show them. This is them. It's The Egotist, and then this is a thing called Don't Let Them Get You Down, and this is a thing called Happy Holly. So these are all books that I wrote, and I was going to self-publish them, and now I don't know what I'm going to do with them, but I'm actually was approached recently by a publisher who's interested in maybe taking them on and putting them back out into the world. So we'll see. We'll see. But that's what I was doing during that time as far as a writer. I wasn't really getting into I didn't really start writing screenplays professionally until 2010. And I did a lot of work as a work for hire. So basically no credit, very little money. And I wrote, I've probably written like 20, well over 20 screenplays, but I did, I wrote a lot of movies that were distributed ultimately by Disney for kids. So I did a lot of talking dog movies and movies about polar bears and, you know, in Florida and into the nature.
I, I know that you did that, but obviously the love of horror came through because I saw on the IMDb credit something that was just amazing. The Satan Paws 2.
Santa.
Oh.
What's the Santa? Santa Paws 2? We've had this conversation.
See, now this is a Rorschach test, and you failed.
And you should have known by the graphic of the little white puppy, you know, puppies that it was.
I just thought that they had put the wrong poster on there. So tell us what it was
I'm sorry, let me interrupt real quick before it goes away. I got somebody on the, but this live chat thing is working out really great so far. So I hope you people watching live keep using it. But Philip, I got to tell you that somebody just said. I'm reading this now. I kind of stumbled into here ass backwards, but hey, I just finished reading Mother the other day. You're a fantastic writer, Philip. So sorry to interrupt you guys, but I wanted to
interrupt anytime.
Yeah, interrupt with that shit, right?
Yeah, and bring that all the way in.
Yeah, if you are watching live, or if you're listening later and you do want to watch live sometimes, since this is working out, this live chat function is available if you're watching directly on the YouTube video page. Of course, you can watch it from Lovecraft eZine website, but what you're really watching is the video embedded there. So if you click over to the actual video page, then you'll see that chat function. So, but yeah, go ahead. Satan Paws 2, I think that's where we were.
Satan Paws 2, the Satan Pups.
Satan Pups.
Yeah. So that was it.
So last week, my littlest girl, who's 7, she comes to me and says, Daddy, when I grew up, I want to be a writer just like you. I'm like, okay, well, what do you want to write? Well, I really like that movie we watched last week. I want to write a story like that, you know, with dogs at the North Pole. I want to write a sequel to Santa Pups 2. Yeah. I'm not joking.
Wow.
She yeah.
loves it, that movie.
You know, those DVDs do very well. I wrote, well... Contractually, I'm not allowed to say this, but I don't really care. I wrote like six.
No one's watching, and we're not recording. So
Disney's not watching. Yeah, I wrote like 6 of those movies. The Disney ended up distributing. The reason I got the credit on Santa Paws 2 was because they literally used my script word for word, which is very rare. Usually, you're 1 of 10 writers or whatever. They take this idea, and they kind of piece together. Right. A screenplay. So, yeah, that was the one where they actually used mine. I actually wrote a song for that movie that they ended up, I don't want to say they ended up using because that would definitely be illegal, but it was a song that they ended up using. So,
you know, before Kelly jumps back in with the horror stuff, I got to say, you know, there are some people who look down on, let's say, children's books, children's movies, the writers, directors, or hell, anyone voicing the animals and those types of things, but I don't, you know, and I think if you're a parent and you love your kids, you don't either, because I gotta imagine there's gotta be so much, it's gotta be so much more difficult than it looks to make that all come together into an entertaining story, you know? So.
Yeah. The key thing is with those movies is you want to balance being really funny for 5-year-olds, and being entertaining for their folks, and without it being overly silly or overly sappy and that kind of stuff. I mean, a lot of that stuff is more part of the responsibility of the director, but from the script perspective, when writing the script, I always try to be funny and always, you know, little kid humor, but also try and incorporate stuff, even small in-jokes that, so, like, guys who have kids or girls who have kids could enjoy the film as well, at least do it. Not so it wouldn't be totally torturous.
Yeah. So.
When you got into those movies, was that work for hire, where they just approached you and said, this is what we're doing, or was there a real interest on your part in getting into children's movies?
No, it was offered. I had a friend... it was one of those things, like anything in Hollywood, you have a friend who has a friend who has a friend. And they'd read The Egotist, which is my self-published novel, literary novel, and loved it, and just offered me, you know, offered me a job. They said, you want to take a crack at writing Spooky Buddies? And I was like, yeah, that sounds great. And I'd written a couple screenplays, but it had been a long time. So I had to kind of train myself how to write them and how to write them professionally, and the reaction, much like what I'm doing now with the stories, the reaction was so positive that it really inspired me to kind of go for it, learn more, write more, you know, and they kept hiring me, you know, back and back, over and over again, which is great. And then I started writing, as a work for hire for other people, and I did that a lot. And I do rewrites, and I do punch ups, and then that developed into writing what I wanted to write, which was thrillers and horror stories. And I've written a bunch of those on spec. One of them was bought and produced, which is called Girl Missing, which stars Francesca Eastwood. And that was one that came out, I think it was last year. It was on Lifetime Television first, and now it's on demand. And then I wrote, I'm currently writing a movie called Vintage with the same producer, same director. And we're doing rewrites right now, and that's going to hopefully go into production early next year. So that's one of those things that it will be my next release, one way or another.
Can you say anything about what the storyline is or anything like that?
Yeah, it's about a young woman who lives in LA, who's a fashion wannabe fashion designer, and she buys some old vintage clothing, and the clothing ends up, when touched or put on for whatever reason, it ends up sending her back into that person's life who owned those clothes. So she kind of, the movie bounces between the 50s and current day. And of course, the woman who clothes she's putting on was horribly, brutally murdered. And so she's kind of solving what happened to this person, both in the past and in the future simultaneously.
That's kind of what Vintage is.
It's a thriller with some horror, some pretty horrific elements that hopefully they'll stay. I had a lot of horror written into Girl Missing, which did not make the final cut, final draft. So I'm hoping that some of the more horrific elements in this one stay. It really depends who ends up producing it, who ends up distributing it. Because if it's Lifetime, they like their stuff a little more thriller-based. But if it ends up being like a straight-to-video or a small cable channel or whoever, Amazon, who knows, then maybe there can be a little more horror in it. So we'll see.
Can I jump in with a question real quick, Kelly,
I'm so sorry, man.
You know how I am. Is that one of the reasons why you started writing and self-publishing recently, like the last several years? Because Girl Missing, it started off as one thing, but then Lifetime buys it, and so it has to morph a little bit into what will fit what they want, but you don't have to do that with a book or story in most cases, let's say, obviously, if you're a publisher, but, for purposes of argument, and certainly if you self-publish. Was that a factor?
First of all, it's night and day. Screenwriting is not... Screenwriting, you're creating a core concept, a core story that has, call it, 15 beats. And those are the 15 beats that you're selling. You're also selling quality of dialogue and that kind of thing. But you know going into it that everything about that screenplay is going to change. A screenplay is a foundation for others to build the movie upon. So you're building a foundation that the director can put his vision into, the actors can put their talents into. It varies by budget, if it's a $1 million movie or if it's a $50 million movie, obviously. So I don't write screenplays the way I write stories. I write screenplays, I'm pitching the idea, and then fleshing it out as part of a team. And anyone who goes into writing screenplays thinking anything else is in for a rude surprise, because it's not like you have your baby and this is word for word. I mean, if you're a director, a writer-director, you can get away with that to a degree, but not as a spec writer. So, what happened was one day I was working at a marketing company, and I hated it. And I just kind of made the decision. I called my girlfriend and I said, you know, why don't I try and do the writing thing? Why don't I combine these two things that I love? I love writing. I've been doing a lot of literary writing. I love writing these horror movies and thrillers. Why don't I just start trying to write that and see what happens? And so I did. And I had been chatting with Laird Barron about something I wanted, the option of his. And when I wrote something, I asked him if he would be interested in reading it. And him shockingly said, yeah, he would, which is incredibly sweet of him because he didn't know me from anybody else. And it was on the strength of his feedback and on the strength of his guidance and on the strength of his enthusiasm for what I had done that I decided, I was kind of like, oh, man, I might actually be able to do this, you know. So I kind of went for it. I threw myself into it. And that was, you know, that first story was what ended up being Mother. But it was an interesting process. And now I've been writing, you know, everything, you know, from Mother onward has really only been in the last year, almost quite literally the last year. So I'm really, really new to this in the horror genre sense. So I'm definitely feeling my way. I'm definitely learning a lot. I'm getting amazing input from people who've been doing it a long time. It's been the funnest year of my life. So I there are people who have come out of the woodwork to support me, and so it's been great. And Mother, you know, I sent Mother to Jordan Crawl at Dunham's Manor Press, and he loved it and he bought it, and that was it. I was up and running. So yeah, and it's so neat because Laird Barron, you know, who's become a really good friend and somebody who I, you know, can't really tell you how highly I think of him, because without him I wouldn't be doing this at all. I would never have ventured into the prose world. But guys like Paul Tremblay and Ted Grau, you know, were incredibly, Adam Neville, were incredibly responsive early on and supportive and read my stuff and gave me feedback on my stuff and blurbed my stuff. And this is, I'm nobody. I'm still nobody. But what a great thing. What a great community. What a, you know, wonderful people to take a chance on reading my material. So it's been a good ride. I've really enjoyed it. I don't know if I even answered your question. I don't remember what the question was.
And it was a Mike Davis question. It's, nobody cares.
You know what? You took the words right out of my mouth, Kelly. That's true. As long as the guest is talking, then whatever I asked must have been brilliant.
Nice. If I was a Lovecraft monster, who would I be?
I think it was, how do you get your ideas, but maybe.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. I dream them. I have horrible nightmares every night. You're welcome.
Well, speaking about going back to some of the things you were saying there, so Girl Missing, that must have been a pretty big thrill. This is kind of the genre you want to be in, and somebody picked it up and made it and distributed it. Were you happy with the finished product?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it was really cool because I got to actually go to Minnesota. We shot in Minnesota, and because I had worked with, it's going to sound like I'm full of it, but I'm not. It's really amazing. It was completely random that the guys who I worked for on my very first movie, on Maniac Cop 3, ended up producing and directing Girl Missing. I mean, pretty randomly. A guy named Joel Soisson is the director, and Mike Leahy is the producer, and those are guys who I've known for 25 years. So it was such an amazing experience because Joel was hired by Mar Vista, and we had a history. I got to go to the set, and I got to work for a month. I worked very closely with Joel on set, and I got to interact with the actors, and I was rewriting dialogue every day, and I got to direct some second unit scenes with the actors, and I got to direct a drone, you know, day. So it was amazing. It was a wonderful experience. So I'm really happy with the end product. It's not the movie I initially wrote, but it's the movie I eventually wrote. You know, I was the only one who touched the script. So it comes down to, you know, giving everybody what they want and keeping what is sacred, you know, in place. That's the balance. So you have to give, you know, you have to give the studio what they want. You have to do it for the money. You have to hit the right tone. You have to give the director what he or she wants, the actors what they want, and they do have a lot of input on set. So, but then you have to, but there are, so, you know, I was talking to a friend about this recently, and he was like, you don't have to be a yes man in regards to, you know, him. He was the guy who's publishing my work, and I said, yeah, I said, I'm not a yes man. I'm going to say yes 14 times, but I'll say no the 15th time, because there are definitely things that are sacred and that are untouchable, and that are quote unquote part of the artwork or part of the piece that is important to me. And the rest of the stuff, especially with the screenplay, you have to be able to let go, and you have to be able to reshape and customize, and that's what I did. So yeah, I'm really happy with it. It's a low budget film, but it's, you know, I think it's really beautiful and somewhat hypnotic. And would I have loved to have made it for $5 million instead of, you know, $800,000? Yeah, I would have. But we could have done a lot more. But I think for what is on screen, it looks like a $5 million movie for sure.
And that's so rare that, that you were allowed on the set as a writer, but then were brought in to direct a couple of scenes, even if they were just second unit scenes. That's not something that normally happens. You sell your script, and that's the last you see of it.
Yeah, and that only happened because I knew the director. We had, like I said, we were old pals, so he kind of, you know, and he's a great guy on top of it. So, that was why that happened. If it had been a director who I didn't know, I'm sure I would not have been involved. I probably would have gone to set, and I probably would have hung out. And as a writer, you know, you are there correcting dialogue or rewriting scenes as needed. To be able to interact as much as I did with the production was really cool, yeah.
So we've spoken a bunch about this film. You want to give just a brief synopsis to people? I know it's available on Amazon right now.
Yeah, it's on Amazon and iTunes. It's about a girl. I'm trying to remember. I wrote it like 3 years ago. It's about a girl who has amnesia, and when she's like in her 20s, social services contacts her and says, "Hey, guess what? We found your birth parents. They came forward after all this time for whatever reason." Which is outlined in the movie. So she goes to this, she finds out that she not only she find her birth parents, but they're filthy rich. She drives, she goes to this huge estate, this, you know, mansion, and meets her mother, and the mother's got a creepy new husband, and then there's all this mist, and then so as she's slowly remembering her past, there's a ghost that appears, a little girl ghost is hanging out at the mansion as well. So there's kind of this mystery that she's slowly unsolving as her memories slowly come back. And she finds out ultimately, without giving anything away, that the situation is not as pleasant as she had hoped it would be. So so there's a bunch of scary stuff that happens to her, and as things progress. But that's basically it. Amnesia, goes finds out she's rich, and then finds out maybe that the mother is not the sweet, loving woman that she thought she was. And there might be ulterior motives to having her return. If that makes sense.
Cool. So during all of this then, like you said, you also wrote and then self-published 3 novels, right? The Egotist and then...
Don't Let Them Get You Down.
Right.
And Happy Holly. Yeah, I call it my literary trilogy, but I only... self-published Egotist. The books I showed you are, mock-ups that I had printed because I was deciding whether or not to do it. And interestingly, when I started, you know, getting some traction on the horror front, I wasn't really sure what to do with these older literary stories because I didn't want to confuse people as to what I was doing. So, I mean, I'm kind of an old school horror writer with maybe, you know, a dash of the new weird, but I think this early in the game, I didn't really want to come out and say, oh, and also, by the way, here's my three literary novels. So I wasn't sure what to do with them. I was kind of on hold on it. And then, like I said, I got contacted recently by a publisher who might be interested in putting them out. And if that happens, obviously that would be amazing and kind of a dream come true in the sense that, you know, I wrote these books so long ago, and they mean a lot to me, and they're very personal books, and they're pretty, you know, they're not happy stories. They're pretty dark, and they're pretty sordid. So they're not going to be too far astray from the horror genre, but it would be cool to get them out. It'd be one of those things where you put a lot of work into something. It always feels good to get it out into the world. So it would be great if they did get back out there into circulation and people could enjoy them or not enjoy them, but people could check them out. I think that'd be fun.
Yeah, when I was doing the research, I was looking for a copy of The Egotist, and Amazon had, I think, one copy available for $98 or something ridiculous like that, and I was asking you about it, and it was because you had actually printed up a certain amount of copies, right?
Yeah. I only printed 1,000.
Yeah, only 1,000, but you sold out of 1,000 copies.
Yeah, they're totally out of print, yeah. And they're only expensive, understand this, they're only expensive because online book dealers, this is how they do their business. Yeah. They have a find a book, they Google it, and they see another dealer has it for $100. So they're like, oh my God, this book must be worth $100. So they put their book at $100. Or, you know, so that's kind of how it works. When you have something there's only a few of, you know, I think sometimes it gets into that, you know, that racket. But
although Philip, I think you'll agree with me, Philip, though, that if Kelly were really dedicated, he would have bought that book for $98 before the interview.
I think I sent him a Moby.
Yeah, he screwed himself out of it.
I ended up putting it out as an ebook, and like I said, that was because I was kind of feeling my way on those things. So I just wanted to get it out there. A lot of people were emailing me or contacting me about it, and they were like, what's up with The Egotist? And after I went through the 20-minute preface of explaining to them that this was an early work and it was not horror, I finally decided just to kind of make an ebook so that at least it would be available. So I did that, and then we'll see. Yeah, we'll see if this publisher wants to put them out. That'd be cool. But I have a lot of horror coming out, so my plate is full.
I kind of want to touch on the fact, though, that you self-published a book and sold 1,000 copies of it. That's pretty amazing. There are a lot of small presses that would love to sell 1,000 copies of a book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you're awfully driven when you pay for the books up front. So I think nowadays it's on demand, print on demand. It's like if you sell, there's no, you don't have a garage full of boxes of books that you need to move. So, it helped that I owned a bookstore. So, I was pimping my own product quite a bit. But, whatever. I mean, I sold, there was probably like 200 or 300 copies that burned up in a warehouse fire. So I probably only ended up selling like 780 something. But, I sold a lot of them. And I actually published, I had my own publisher. I still do. It's called Equator Books. But I actually published 6 other books from different authors all over the country, and some of them did really well. As you know, I sold one from a writer from New Orleans named Michael Patrick Welch. You know, we sold a couple thousand copies of his book called The Donkey Show. So, yeah, so I was publishing for a while early on. It was part of what I was doing at the bookstore too. So we kept the publishing company going while the bookstore was open, and then when the bookstore went down, I dropped it. You know, I had other things I wanted to focus on.
Right. I'm about halfway through The Egotist right now, and it is very different from your horror stuff, but it has kind of, without the gore, it has kind of an American Psycho feel to me.
Yeah, it's a pretty dark characterization. And the goal, that was a book that I wrote because I wanted to write the character. So it's really a character-based novel. Don't Let Them Get You Down is a novel about another, also character-based. It's about a guy who is suffering from depression. And what I wanted to cover was not necessarily this depressed guy, but I wanted to cover what happens because I've suffered from depression. I've gone through it, and it's incredibly difficult to get through that. So what I wanted to write about was how hard it is to get back into the real world, to start dating again, to make friends again, you know, that part of it. So that's kind of what that book's about, is how do you rebuild your life? And then Happy Holly is a story about a starlet gone wrong, about a woman who comes to L.A. to make her name, and things go really poorly for her. So that's kind of what that book's about. So it's a little trilogy of character-based novels that I'm really proud of, so hopefully they'll find a home.
Yeah, unlike all the happy things that happen in, say, Alter or Mother.
Right, those are feel-good. Those are feel-good books.
Yeah, that's feel-good horror, yeah.
Let's get into Alter, which is the first thing I read of yours. And, man, it just stuck with me, and it has stuck with me this entire time. I really, really love that book. And I think part of it is because of the same attraction that, say, Stranger Things has had on people. You really tapped into a nostalgic feel there with the smells and the sights of going to, you know, a local swimming area. And then everything, of course, goes horribly awry.
Yeah, it's a dark book. You know, it's cool because it's one of those things where we all have had that day, right? We've all been in the back of the wagon, so to speak, and gone to the pool. And I wanted to create that atmosphere. And a lot of my stuff I tend to write not necessarily 80s but definitely pre-technology. And I actually had a conversation recently with somebody online about this. I think it might have been Pete, actually, who we talked about technology usage and stories and what a nuisance they are, because there's nothing worse in a horror story than having somebody with a frickin' cell phone. So right. Pete and I were talking about this, and I was like, I don't know how many times I've cheated, the whole like, you know, no reception, darn it, you know, and or whatever. Like, I'm not getting a signal. So it's such a pain, and I hate doing it. So with the pros anyway, I try to either stay out of it completely or really emphasize it and make it part of the story. So Alter specifically, as well as Mother, they're pretty timeless. There's no cell phones, there's no internet, there's no computers. It's all about the people and the characters and what's happening to them on the ground. And Alter was a bit of a throwback, childhood throwback, and there's little kids involved, obviously. So that kind of also, I think, gives you that sense of nostalgia, because you read about little kids, you feel the way you felt when you were a little kid. And it kind of opens up some doors in your head and in your heart that I like to exploit, which is why I kind of, in some ways, like writing about kids, because it's easier for me to mess with people's heads than if you write about adults.
Yeah, let me jump in with a question from the audience then, real quick, Kelly, because it concerns that. Alan Scott writes, Mother concerns the fears of a new father. Alter concerns parents losing control of their children. Has it been a conscious thing to focus on family as a nexus of horror? So maybe you partially answered that already, but if you want to add any more to that.
That was my next question, so you can tell whoever wrote that.
Of
thanks
course.
A lot.
Sorry, it's Alan Scott. Damn it.
Yeah.
This guy, these people, they want to, yeah. Maybe you shouldn't have posted your questions publicly.
If everyone could just stop listening to this so I could conduct this interview.
Well, it's obviously a good question, though, because it's coming in from multiple sources.
Exactly.
No, I don't intentionally write about families. I actually had somebody else ask me recently if I intentionally write about screwed up parents. No, but I think it's dramatic, right? I think the family unit is a microcosm of our world, our personal world, and to tear that apart and to monstrify it is incredibly satisfying. So I think as a reader and a writer. So I just think it happens that way. It's definitely a tool that I can use to create a dramatic situation. And I just read Naomi's Room, which was amazing. And, you know, that's again, it's about tearing the child away from the family unit and all the things that, all the drama and emotion that follow that. There's a lot of stories like that. It's a pretty obvious trope. I'm trying not to focus on it every time. The novella that I have that's coming out in November by Journalstone is called Fragile Dreams. And that is about one guy trapped under a building for, you know, whatever, 100 pages. And that's the book. That's the story. So, you know, there's going to be different focuses. Most of it has to do with what do I want to affect? What am I, like, for example, you know, how do I want to scare people? What kind of ride am I taking them on? With Alter, it was definitely like, Alter to me is an operatic type story, tragedy, where I wanted to create enough characterization and enough of a warm, fuzzy feeling so that when I tore it all apart, it would be a little, you know, more effective for the reader. Fragile Dreams is where I'm dealing more with isolation and what comes into your head when isolated, especially when you're isolated in a potentially fatal situation. So, like, it kind of depends on what I'm trying to get across, and I use the characters as needed.
And Journalstone's publishing that in November?
Yeah.
Will that be print and Kindle, I'm assuming, knowing Chris, but...
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, we could talk about the Journalstone deal now if you want. I have...
Whatever you want to do is fine.
Yeah, I have three books coming out with Journalstone. So I have the Fragile Dreams, which is coming out in November, which is a novella. There's also a bonus story with that, which is kind of fun. So that's November, and then I have the collection coming out in March of 2017. Mother and Alter are both in the collection, but primarily the collection is original fiction. There's a brand new 28,000 word novella in there that's pretty scary, and then a bunch of other shorts. So and then after that in May. Currently scheduled for May next year is another novella called Saculina, which is pretty much straight up old school horror, and that's coming out in May. So that's the three I have currently lined up with Journalstone, and we're in talks about doing more. So it's really a matter of me getting the material out, you know, making the donuts and writing. But yeah, well, I hope to work with those, you know, with Chris Payne at Journalstone, and he's been great. You know, he's a believer, so I want to definitely keep chugging along with him and see what we can do. It should be really fun. I'm looking forward to it. Oh, by the way, I mentioned it. The title of the collection is called Behold the Void, so that's what it'll be titled. It's going to be fun. The stories that are in there are all to a degree cosmic horror. There's a couple that are not. I wouldn't call them cosmic horror, but they all have definitely streaks of it running through. And a couple of the stories are going to be previously published. In addition to the Mother and Alter, there's one story called Baby Farmer, which is going to be in an anthology by Aegeus. I think I'm pronouncing that right, Aegeus Press, later this year. And then there's going to be Coffin, which is going to be in Strange Eons later this year. There's one other one. But yeah, so it's a good collection. It's a lot of fun new stuff. I am hoping it's going to be even more wild and more scary than Alter and Mother, so I'm really hoping people enjoy it.
I can't wait for that.
Yeah, it's pretty dark. I mean, the thing with, you know, writing horror, at least for me, is I don't want to do something that's already been done. I don't see the point of writing a story that is something you've already read or experienced. There's a lot of those ideas, you know, and I'm not just talking about tropes. I'm talking about the feeling and the vibe, or, you know, that. There's only so many ghost stories you can write. There's only so many, you know, vampire stories you can write and stuff like that. But there's also so many stories you can write that, you know, that are weird or that are abstract or that are... I mean, my stuff is definitely you know, I write my stories a bit like I write my screenplays. I write them, you know, there are typically acts. You know, there's a beginning, there's a middle, there's an end. There's an act one, an act two, and an act three. And there's, I mean, it's a story. You know, you're going to find out what happens at the end. I'm not going to get 80% there and then bail and just kind of get weird and philosophize about, you know, choose your own ending, which I think a lot of people do. But, you know, I'm definitely more of a storyteller in the sense that I'm writing to entertain people. I want people to have fun. I want people to be scared. I want it to be a bit of a bit of a ride, you know, a bit of a haunted house. That's kind of my goal. I'm definitely probably more commercially focused than a lot of the writers who maybe are focusing more on just weird stuff or more abstract stuff. I'm really trying to drive stories out there and create stories that people can become engrossed in and follow and feel satisfied at the end that, wow, that was a journey and that was an experience and that was a wild ride. And hopefully they'll want to do it again and again.
Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that because I think the real error is a swinging the pendulum too far one way or another, you know, trying to just write a book that's going to sell, or on the other hand, you can write a story that three people are going to be interested in, but, you know,
yeah,
can't keep doing it forever either.
Yeah, and I think you write what you know. Like I said, I mean, I've been writing screenplays now for a long time, and I've become accustomed to writing. So I can, you know, there's only one way I can write a story, which is I kind of have to tell you what happens. So that's what I do. And you know, I get ambiguous, and I get a little, you know, there's definitely give you some room to kind of fill in some blanks on your own in some of the stories. But for the most part, yeah, like. I like him to be, I'm kind of in that, you know, that mold of sort of the old school novelist, you know, where you're taken on a journey and you get there, you arrive at the destination. That's usually pretty scary stuff, hopefully.
Yeah. You know, I went to film school and it was a film school that just focused on story structure and character development. And while I was reading Alter, all I could think was either this guy is a screenwriter, or he should be, because it was just so beautifully visual as I was reading it. You know, I mean, it was beautiful and horrifying. It really is a disturbing story, but yeah. The visuals were so strong. I just saw everything as a film in my head.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely, one of the skills that you learn as a screenwriter is you have to be able to describe something visually. You have to be able to, when the director's reading a scene, they have to be able to visualize it very, very clearly. So I'm sure that is a big part of what goes into my prose is I definitely want, I'm definitely trained to write stuff that you can see very clearly and dialogue that's very real, hopefully, and authentic. And it does help. It helps you get into the story a lot quicker, and it helps you kind of immerse yourself in the experience So yeah, it's been a lot of fun. I've enjoyed writing the prose so much that I've actually really scaled back on writing my screenplays. So I've been kind of focusing a lot more on that the last 6 months or so. So how it goes, I don't know. But like I said, I think once the Journal Stone stuff comes out, I think people are going to like the collection a lot, and then we'll see. We'll see where I go from there. I have a novel I'm working on already. I might be starting something else with them. I'm in talks to do a novelization for an entertainment company, so that might be something I do. So right now I'm just kind of focused on getting the collection out and getting these stories I have currently going and then seeing what happens, but it's exciting right now.
Well, I have one last question. So you've talked about the stuff that's coming out, fiction, and then you talked about vintage, but then on your IMDb, it says in production something called Escape the Night.
Yeah. Well, there's others. The way it works is when you sell a screenplay, that's another screenplay that I've sold. And what happens is these production companies, they open up shop. So they buy the screenplay, they set up a production, you know, a little production company, and then they go out and they find the money. So that's where the in development comes in. It means they're finding the money. So Escape the Night is an action movie that I wrote. I've written a few action movies, actually, that was bought and now they're actively trying to find distribution and or financing for that. So once they find it, if they find it, then yeah, then that movie will go. There's a few movies that I have that are in that stage. But you just, yeah, people, it's hard. That's the hardest part about the process is finding the distribution and finding the money. But once you have a director attached and a script and potentially maybe a big name actor or an actor that can make a little money overseas, it's a lot easier to do that. It's a lot easier to finance it. So, but that's someone else's job. My job is to write it and give them a script that they can produce for a certain amount of money. And that's what that is, yeah.
Yeah. Well, just to wrap things up on my end, I just want to remind everybody that the people that were saying that they couldn't respect you as a writer because you were doing the things you were doing with small presses might not have realized all the shit you are actually doing that they'd love to be doing. You're making a living in this industry.
Yeah, I mean, I think... Yeah, and the one thing I'll address about that, and one thing I'll address about the small press self-published thing is, and I had a discussion with another author about this that was a bit of a misunderstanding, got a little prematurely heated, it ended up being cool, but is, I think you have to find your own way. I think, like we talked about a couple weeks ago, whether you're an artist or a musician or a painter or a photographer or a writer, I think you have to find your own path and decide the best way for you. And everyone has different goals. Everyone has, different levels of success they want to achieve. I think, for me, starting, with a small press was the right thing to do because it got my work out there. People read it. The right people read it. I had a calling card of sorts that I could send to other writers and publishers and distributors. And obviously, people had to enjoy the story. But that... Those books got me, those little, chapbooks got me the Journalstone deal.
Right.
So, and now I'm publishing with Journalstone. So I think you have to, I don't think there is a wrong way to do it. I think there's unique ways to do it. I think you have to listen to yourself and do it the way you think is right for you. And don't let anybody, I mean, there's a lot of writers out there giving really great advice and are very supportive. And I think that's wonderful. There's also a lot of writers out there that think they know what the right thing is for everyone else. And the reality is that the only person that knows what's right for you is you, and you're your biggest fan. And you have to find your own path. And so I always, I'm a big believer and big fan of the new writer and the small writer, the little guy. And I think that, you should do whatever you think is right, and don't let anybody tell you differently. Because, it's your world, man. It's your work, and you can do whatever you want with it.
Yeah, and as a coder, I gotta say, I really appreciate with all the negativity on Facebook and everything, and people complaining about one thing or another, or politics, or any of that stuff. I love that your posts are, check out this new book I just read, and it's awesome, and how you're out there promoting other people. I picked up so many. Things that I never heard of just because you were pushing them. So I personally really appreciate your Facebook feed on my time stuff.
Yeah, it's exciting. I mean, it's exciting when people do well, isn't it? I mean, it's like you said it yourself when you first read Alter, it's exciting to find something new and find something cool. And it does, I want everyone to know about it, and I want that person to do really well. So, yeah, it's, I mean, that's what we're, I don't know. I guess that's where some of the disconnect is. My attitude is very much like, this is all so fun, and this is all such great work, and we're all in this giant sandbox together. And it's definitely something I like to push other people as much as I can, and people who really, there are people out there who promote me and who have helped me, so I try and return that favor as much as I can to other folks.
Yeah, that's the way to be. And in fact, I, as much as I would hate to say anything nice about Kelly Young, he's the one that first let me know, turned me on to your work, Alter. And I read it, and Kelly was right. It's awesome.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Pete. Go ahead.
Well, because I'm gonna do a little joke here. So, Phil, Like, Kelly's mentioned your IMDb profile like four times tonight. And I've read it, and I think you pulled a Lionel Twain.
It's a what?
So we just finished, like today, we just finished our weekly watching of Murder by Death.
Uh-huh.
And there's this great character in there, Lionel Twain, which nobody knows anything about. And the one secretary is like, oh, well, he did this, he did that. He snuck rich people across the border of Mexico to pick cabbages, these things. He's like, oh, that's pretty good. Where'd you get all this information? So I wrote to him and I asked him.
Right.
I think if the database is right, you wrote your own biography for IMDb?
Yeah.
Okay.
Why? What does it say?
It says you wrote your own biography for IMDb.
Yeah. Who else would write it?
Yeah, everybody wrote it. Yeah, on IMDb, you write your own biography, but they won't print it until they've double-checked all of the info.
It's just, I find that, you know, I've never seen that before.
I mean, my IMDb says I have a 12-inch cock, but they won't confirm that.
Great, there goes the show's rating.
Yep.
Yeah, I think it's kind of the opposite of Wikipedia in that way. You're not supposed to touch your Wikipedia page.
Yeah, the way IMDb works is you have, yeah, exactly to Kelly's point, is I don't know if they double-check your biography or not. I could probably say I'm a sultan and they probably wouldn't care, but I think that, but your credits are all triple-checked. You have to submit them and then they check the cast and or the crew list and all that stuff, but yeah. It's a great resource, and as a matter of fact, I was talking to a friend and who had a story optioned for a movie, and I said, dude, you got to put that up on, you got to create an IMDb page, and you got to put yourself as a writer, and you got to put that movie up there, and because this is what the industry looks at. Right. I'm a shameless self-promoter. I think you have to be to a degree, and what I try and at least do is to balance it and not push too hard, but nobody cares, like I said, nobody cares about you as much as you do, and no one's ever going to care as much about you as you do. And if you're not out there, you know, getting yours, and there's people, that said, there are ways to do it, and there are ways to do it
incorrectly. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, you don't want to annoy people, and you don't want to, you know, necessarily bastardize people's time and goodwill.
But I think it's kind of the difference between being a salesman and being good at self-promotion. They're two very different things.
Yeah.
You know, when I was in real estate, there are definitely some, you know, I don't know, 75% of them are salespeople that, what can I do to get you into this house today? And then there are some people that they do this for a living, but they know how to promote themselves. They just want to help you get the right house. You know, there's quite a bit of difference in that.
Yeah, and you'll see that a lot of publishers, on Facebook, they'll reference this. You know, they expect you to do a bit of the lifting. You know, they expect you to call, you know, try and get reviews, and you know, most of my hustling is getting the books into people's hands who I respect, first of all, and then secondarily getting into people's hands who can review it or post about it, or and then hopefully as things move forward, the publisher who I'm working with will do a lot of that in a much bigger way. Right now, you know, social media has its inclusivity of, you know, that world. It's and it's, you have to go beyond it at some point, because you're gonna get the readership. You have to be able to promote yourself beyond social media for sure. So, but that's where hopefully the publisher will come in and assist, and that's why people have publicists and all this other great stuff. But I'm slowly building it. You know, I've only been doing this for a year, so I'm just kind of taking it step by step.
I want to point out to the viewers and/or listeners, Mother, I believe, was the first novella you self-published. Is that right?
Yes.
And there's some, for those who listen to this show, we talk about sometimes it seems like every other thing, but Lovecraftian fiction or cosmic horror. But you know, it's part of weird fiction, and you write weird fiction, you know, in my view anyway. Maybe you disagree, but Mother, there's some Lovecraftian elements in there for sure. For anyone out there who has not read it, I'm not going to call it a Lovecraftian story by any means, but seems to be several Lovecraftian elements.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Golly, I don't know if you can write a horror movie story anymore and not have some element of Lovecraft in there. I mean, he's the giant, you know. And
that's true.
It's like Poe and.
I don't think it's allowed. It's actually against the law in some states.
Yeah, right. You know, we all stand on the shoulders of the giants. So, you know, there is, you know, there is no original story, is the old Hollywood adage. But you try and create something that's a fresh take on it or a fresh perspective on it. I don't disagree with that at all. I mean, I think Mother and Alter are both have their cosmic elements for sure, as do most of my other stories. I actually enjoy putting an element of that into my work because I feel like it makes the story, it feels bigger. It broadens the scope and the scale of what you can do. You know, there's, even if it's internal, you know, what I mean by that is even if it's happening in the character's head, it can still be cosmic. And it's such a fun world to play in. And I'm not a serial killer guy, but I think if you take a serial killer and you combine it with cosmic, you have something that's really fun, and I think it kind of is fresh and can feel fresh versus just having, you know, one more serial killer to write about. So that's why I tend to do it. It's fun for me. It broadens my toolkit, and allows me to do more with the story than I could if it wasn't reflective of some of those themes. Yeah.
And of course, you said that your upcoming collection. There's quite a few cosmic horror stories in there, right?
Yes. Behold the Void is chock full of cosmic horror. There are, besides Mother and Alter, there's 9 stories total. But my stories are long. I tend to write stories in 10,000-word chunks for whatever reason. So it's like the collection will be about 100,000 words. You know, 60% of which will be original. But definitely thematically, there is for sure a cosmic element, and I think pretty much all the stories, except for maybe one. But even that could be argued, to your point, that it does. So I'm really excited about the collection. I think I'm also very excited about the novellas. The novellas are not in the collection. So Fragile Dreams, which is coming out in November, will not be in the collection. That's a 27,000-word story. And then Saculina will also not be in the collection, and that's coming out next May. So that's another, you know, full-size novella. I just didn't have, you know, I could left a lot of stuff out of the collection too, so we had to kind of figure out what was going to be in the collection, and then, you know, having three big, fat novellas in one collection, I thought, and Chris agreed, was probably too much, so we kind of broke it up. A little bit, but yeah. Hopefully there'll be another collection down the line, and those things will be included in those.
That's a great title, by the way. Behold the Void.
Yeah, I struggled with it. People didn't tell me how hard it was to come up with a title for a collection. It's really hard.
No one gave you the title, random title generator.
No,
thing.
I was really disappointed. I was like, why didn't anybody tell me that this was going to be so difficult? Because most of the time,
take the name of the last meal that you ate, and then
right.
No, go on.
Well, yeah. You know what's tricky about it is most people take the story and they make that the title, like occultation or imago sequence in Laird's case. And I probably would have done Alter and other tales of cosmic horror, except that Alter's already a book and it's going to remain a standalone book. So we went with something else. But you want to find, this is not that interesting, but you want to find something that kind of sets the table a little bit, and you also don't want to mislead people. So I don't want people looking at the book and thinking, oh, this is a book about X or Y, when it's not. So I was trying to come up with a title that I thought would give the right feel for the stories that are included.
And it does, not having read the stories yet, but it does for what I've read of your writing so far, and Cosmic Horror, Behold the Void.
Yeah.
I mean, I was thinking just a minute ago when you told us the title that it really struck the mood there.
Yeah, and most of the stories in there are, like I said, are similar. I mean, like Alter and Mother being very different construction, one's more of a modern Gothic and one's definitely like more of a roller coaster. The stories in the new book are all pretty unique. They all have a pretty unique feel, but there's definitely that thread running through for sure. And there's some other ties that you'd have to kind of, you know, that if you end up being a huge Fracassi nut, you can probably find consistencies throughout the stories. But I try and meld a couple worlds and a couple characters, make repeat appearances. But I'm hoping people dig it. It's a lot, you know. You don't know. You write something, you hope people like it. I want people to enjoy it. I want people to have fun and be scared. And that's all I can hope for.
When is the zombie novel coming out? And, you know, we don't have enough zombie stories.
Yeah. I don't know. I should do that. I don't know what I'm...
I always think of that when someone says, you know, you were talking earlier about, you know, there's only so many ghost stories you can do, only so many vampire stories you can do. But apparently there's not too many zombie stories that people can do the last few years.
Yeah, it just, you know, I think it's great that people are doing it, and I think it's great that people are having success with it, and I never want to naysay someone's work. It just doesn't interest me as an artist, as a writer. I really want, and this is going to sound terrible, but I really want to hurt people when I write. You know, I really want you to feel it, and I want it to be something that is different and that you haven't experienced before, you haven't felt before, and I kind of want you to, you know, without, but it's, you know, drop the book and sort of go, eh. But again, it's a balance because I don't want to be you don't want to be overly, I'm not a gore guy either, I'm not there to shock people. So right. I think my thing is I try and kind of lure you in a little bit, and then start slamming things around and see how it shakes out. But
and I totally agree with you on the zombie thing. That was well put. I mean, I would never want to naysay anyone else's work either. But personally, like, I can't even watch The Walking Dead. I tried it and just...
I don't watch it either.
So what are you saying is I should stop writing zombie books?
Do you write zombie books?
Mike said that, not me.
I didn't even know you wrote zombie books. Well, I mean, there's that Reanimator guy, but...
Yeah. You're not using the Z word.
Yeah, I hope that the rest of you weren't quiet because you had no questions. If you do, shout them out at Philip, please. But if Philip, as we always do, we're going to talk about a few other things too, so you're more than welcome to stay if you want. So it's totally up to you. Or if you need to go, that's fine too.
I would love to hang out.
All right.
Just it's fun for me. I do want these are the books. Can I pimp these?
Please
these
do.
These are out right now. It's a nice little set.
Yeah, for those listening later, he's holding up Mother.
I'm holding up my Alter. Yeah, Mother and Alter. And these are both on Amazon currently, and they are both available as paperbacks and as ebooks. And they will both be in the collection as well, as I said. So
And that was quite the ending on Mother, by the way.
Yeah.
Very, very intense.
Yeah, Mother is doesn't go well. But, you know, like I said, it's one of those things where I try and lure you in a little bit. And Mother was, and then I'll let you guys move on, I'm sorry. But what I was going to say is that, you know, Mother was a very different story when I first wrote it, and it was Laird who gave me really, really great advice and continues to give me great advice and just taking really, you know, a few simple things and applying them to the work, made the whole story work out. So it was a lot of fun to see that develop, and now I'm kind of chugging along. But that story would not exist. I mean, without Laird helping me and, you know, giving me some tools and training me a little bit. So I'm really thankful to him for everything he's done for me.
Well,
I'm glad you liked it.
Well, yes, I did, and I know a lot of other people did too. And you know, Laird he's one of those rare people who. Extremely talented, but also a very nice guy. and sounds like he's helped you out quite a bit, and I'm glad he did because he got you started.
Yeah, take some notes, Mike. God.
I know. I'm sorry you hated my work, Matt, but
it wasn't the work, Mike.
It was me? Yeah, I get that a lot. I want to talk to Alex for a minute, or Alex and Matt for a minute, and then don't let me forget, because I didn't want to interrupt Kelly interviewing you and take the focus off of you, but I got a great story about horror stories and technology. Mm-hmm. You know, not having cell phones, that really happened. Something that happened to me when I was young, way younger, and how that night could have turned out, and how it would have been very different with a cell phone. It's amazing. So, hey, Alex.
Hello.
For those who don't know, Alex Kreitner, I would probably personally not exist if it was not for the last year, if it was not for Alex Kreitner, because, or I would be one of those gibbering Lovecraftian protagonists in an asylum somewhere, because he takes many, 95% of the emails I get and answers them for me, among many other things. And him and Matt Carpenter have been are now the editors of Lovecraft eZine. So wanted to talk to these guys about that. And I don't know if I know what to ask, except maybe the first question is for Alex: was it what you expected going in, or did you have any expectations?
I don't think I really had any expectations, but. At least there weren't any huge surprises, but, you know, no. I'd say it was relatively what I expected.
See, I think Alex works a lot harder than I do. Which,
you know, that's true.
That isn't very difficult, though, but he's the one who does more of the work, I believe. I just help read through the slush pile.
Well, Alex does have more responsibility than you do. You both read through the slush pile, and is more responsible, if that wasn't clear. But that slush pile can be a bitch, man, and it's one of the reasons why I basically said to you guys, look, my health is, I try not to show it on this show, take a pain pill before the show and so forth, but it's not getting any better, it's getting worse, and it was that and the fact that I'm focusing on more on publishing books like this upcoming book here, reprint, or, you know, Sea of Ash, Autumn Cthulhu, so on and so forth, publishing a book, a novella by Kristen Dearborn later in the year called Whispers, and a few others. And I really enjoy doing that, and I've been doing the magazine for the past 5 years, so I said to Matt and Alex, I don't know, maybe Lovecraft eZine is just going to become just a small press and not a magazine, and both you guys strongly disagreed that that should happen. I said, well, the only way I can do it is if I have a lot of help. So, and you guys gave that to me. So.
It's I know, you know, things move in light speed in the internet era. When did you start up? 6 years ago, was it? Or something like that?
February 2011.
And I just thought, okay, well, this was... It'd be not just an online community, but also an online forum for fiction provided free of charge to Lovecraftians who don't have access or a lot of money to get other kind of fiction, to get the kind of stories they like. And I just, that mission statement, as it were, I just thought that was just the heart of what you were doing. I would have hated to see that go by the wayside.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And let me just be real clear. I did not want it to go by the wayside. It's just there comes a point where you realize there's only so much you can do, you know?
Sure. Well, now you've got your empire. You know, you've got your financial tentacles and everything. You're kind of like Hydra.
Yeah, something like that's exactly the analogy I was – that was the goal.
So I guess I wanted to ask Alex is, are we ready to reopen – for submissions now, starting on the 1st of September. Are we ready? Are we there?
Yeah, I would say so. Are you ready, Matt?
It's like opening the floodgates, isn't it?
I'm ready to go on a long vacation. It's like So for those viewers out, I'm talking about you and you, both you guys who are viewing this.
There's a few more.
we're going to be flicking the switch back on, and I will just give you the one piece of advice I'll give you is that when you send me a story and you say, please add what you think it needs and make adjustments so it fits in your magazine, I'm probably not going to read much more of it.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So wait, you guys are open for submissions September 1st? I'm making a note.
This is not like a big money submission. Just, you know, for you hotshot Hollywood types. You know, with the Scarlets and your Cadillac.
Well, wait a second now. Strange Eons is printing them, so.
Yeah.
They're not any better than we are.
Kelly said the check was in the mail.
I'm sure it's not either.
Oh, yeah. Nobody ever claimed we were any better than anybody.
I'm just saying, Matt, if he's good enough for Strange Eons, he's good enough for us. That's all I'm trying to say.
Who are you insulting here? I don't quite get it.
It's me. It's always me.
Yeah. Yeah, or knowing that it's Cosmic Horror Magazine, and we do stretch that sometimes, right, Alex? But
yeah, we try not to.
We actually, if we're going to do a pastiche, it's got to be damn good. We prefer weird stuff with the cosmic bent that's new, well written.
I mean, oh, well, wait, you're publishing me.
Yeah, but you write good pastiche.
We said we were publishing you.
You know, actually, that was part of my blurb for Pete's upcoming book, Reanimatrix. I think I said something about pastiche.
You did.
And something along the lines of, I was probably drunk, but proving that Pete Rawlick proves that there's still great Lovecraftian pastiche being written. But yeah, God, usually it's crappy. Not his, in general.
I thought that was still part of the quote.
The whole thing, yeah.
It was. Yeah, you got it all. Not his.
But what I did was I said, take this blurb and edit it down as you see fit if it'll work for your book.
He actually did say that. Wait.
Yeah, the really funny thing is he sent the blurb back to me the first time saying, no, it won't work.
He didn't say that.
Yeah, but that's what you meant.
No. Never mind.
To get off topic a second, hey, Pete, didn't you just get some kind of really big review for your latest book?
Yeah, you know, I just, for Reanimatrix, it's coming out in October, and Mandy just sent me a note saying that it's in this week's issue of Publishers Weekly.
I thought she said Publishers Clearinghouse.
No, not
Publishers. Congratulations, Pete.
You know, it's not a starred review, but, you know, they have, you know, it's a little choppy in places. Okay, fine. You know what? I'll take that. I'll take it.
When does the book come out, Pete?
October 8th, I think we're shooting for. So, cool. Yeah. Awesome. They didn't say don't buy it.
So good review, then.
I'll take that. I'll take what I can get. They hated the last two books. So.
Oh, they did. Well, I really liked the last one.
I know. A lot of people didn't like those two books. A lot of people did not like Weird Company. So
I
really,
huh? Funny,
but hey, whatever. I'll take what I can get. So I'm really happy with it. The book's been edited to death. It's, you know, I've had a lot of fun with it, and I think it's going to be a really good book, and I hope people will like it.
Well, congratulations on the Publishers Weekly thing.
Yeah, that's cool. Maybe I can eat this month.
Yeah. So let's get back to Alex for a second, and Matt, if he wants to jump in. Were you guys surprised by how big the slush pile was?
I think I was surprised by how much came in, but it was still manageable. I mean, it was a fair amount, and it was a little intimidating to look at the list, but once we started reading, it wasn't... it was still manageable. Like we, and no point did I feel like we were drowning, but looking at the list felt like that. Yes.
I sort of viewed it like a rabid wolverine. You know, you couldn't turn your back on it, or the damn thing would start jumping up. It's like once you take like 2 days off, suddenly there's 12 more titles there.
So. That's true. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's all the work that you don't see that in a magazine, right, Kelly? I mean, all the stuff that, well, maybe I don't, you're invite only, I think.
Yeah, so. for the most part. Also, I just, yeah, I would have no idea. I pass it all off to Justin. So.
Oh, well, it's a good policy. That's what I just did with these two. All right, so we just did issue 37 a couple months ago. Issue 38 is going to come out, I would say, probably within the next week here. Mm-hmm. Aaron French helped with issue 37, or he was doing issue 37. We added some stories, however you want to look at it. What's in store for issue 39?
The 39?
Is that the one that Robert Price's story is going to be in?
That's correct, yes. We have a Robert Price story, Invaders from the Black Lagoon. A few other ones, some ones I'm pretty excited about. I mean, one called Floater that I'm particularly fond of, and another one called Library of Lang. Floater's by a guy named Richard Lee Byers. Library of Lang's by a guy named Sebastian Normandin. Both excellent stories. This latest one, as Mike pointed out, we have a few big names. I think we're going to have a little bit less than 29, or 39, sorry, but definitely not quality-wise less.
Yeah, I guess I did jump one. Who's in issue 38?
Oh, yes, 38, that one. We got that Rollick guy.
Sometimes you need a filler.
Yeah. He's scrambling at the last minute, find something in the corner of the dustbin there. We also have one by Douglas Wine. Good one. Mike Griffin. Yeah. Yep. Actually one by a guy named Marcus Grimm called Catch Me If You Can, which I'm very fond of.
That was really good.
Mm-hmm. It was.
So, Alex, you focused on the Richard Lee Byers story for issue 39. You like his work? His Lovecraftian work?
I liked that one. I couldn't give you any kind of thought on anything he's ever done in his entire life, but that one was good.
So I've known Richard for about 20 to 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he's on the west coast of Florida, and he's written a lot of fantasy fiction for a lot of publishing houses, you know, gaming fiction and whatnot. And when I was doing Legacy of the Reanimator, I asked him to contribute a story.
Mm-hmm.
And he came back to me and said that no one ever in his entire career had asked him to write a Lovecraftian story before. And this was the first one. And since then, I think he's published like a half dozen. So it's opened up a whole new field for him. And I'm really happy to see that happen. I think he's a decent writer. I got a lot of books of his on my shelf. So
you're responsible for the entry, is that what you're saying?
I will take a small smidgen of credit.
The paycheck.
Yeah.
I have a question. You mentioned Bob Price's Invaders from the Black Lagoon. Is that a tie-in to Creature from the Black Lagoon then?
Yes, absolutely.
I cannot wait for this.
Well, since Mike got the numbers wrong, you're going to be waiting a few months. But the other one is going to be coming out.
Oh, it's my fault. God.
Yeah. That's why your name's on the top.
Yeah, true.
I hesitate to say it also. We are reading poetry. So if poetry comes in, I do read it, and we consider it for acceptance. But, you know...
Got to be damn good.
Yeah, really. Well, at least I've got to enjoy it before we make it past the first hurdle. So.
Yeah, SP.
As an editor of fiction who has plowed through my fair share of slush piles, what are you guys really tired of seeing, and what would you really like to see?
The non-Pete Rollick-esque pastiche. There's a fair amount of just, actually, in a very specific vein, I would say, as much as I kind of fond of the genre, action sci-fi, I rarely ever read one that I'm really impressed with. There's a lot of it, and
I really dislike H.P. Lovecraft as a character.
Oh, yeah.
That is like, you have to like, if it's not superbly written, even if it is, I'm going to go, man. I don't know. It's really, I'll take, but you know, the thing is, anything is okay if the prose is really good.
I liked The Broken Hours by Jacqueline Baker.
Yeah.
Novel. We had her on the show, but I'll tell you what, that is an exception. I don't like it either. Lovecraft as a character and a story.
Yeah.
It's so hard to say, you know, again, like, when we open the slush pile up, and we'll get like, I don't know, 100, 120, 130 stories, it all sorts of starts to blur together, too. Yeah. And if the prose doesn't grab you right away, it's not going to have a prayer.
Now, Alex, I know you had a lot of questions for me at the beginning, and I'm curious, this is to you and Matt, how much do you read of a story? Let's say you've read the first three paragraphs, and it's just god-awful. Do you personally, you know my advice on this subject, but do you guys both personally continue reading, or do you send them the polite, this won't work letter, and that's it?
Well, I'm kind of obsessive about it, where I try to read all of them, but if it's looking at like a 10, 20,000 word story, and you know, 1,000 words in, I don't care for it. I just am nice to myself and I shut it off. But for the most part, I try to read all of them. I think I fool myself into thinking that it's going to be good by the end, when really it never is. So.
I always used to stop at the point at which I felt like I was being nice.
That's probably a good
key.
Yeah.
What about you, Matt?
I'm very similar to Alex in that regard. If I can, I try and gut it out, because these stories, most part, they're not long. They're like 2,000, 3,000 words, and it's really, I mean, I'm reading them like at work on my lunch break, you know, it's like, what else I got to do? But if I find myself, I'm starting to skim it, then I just skim it, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If we were at this, like, say, ask us again in a year, and it might be that, like, we'll read three words and say,
I agree.
What advice do you guys have for, you're about to open the slush pile again in a few days. What advice do you guys have for writers that are going to submit their stories?
For story content, I would say make sure something happens. I mean, I guess one of the problems in some of the Lovecraftian ones is something that's just a theme or a feeling, and it just continues throughout the whole piece, and by the end, nothing has changed, nothing has gone anywhere. Have some change from the beginning to the end. I think that's pretty important, because that's something that's not always done.
I also would say, just mentioning Lovecraft's monsters, or a tone, you don't have to invent a new one. Just mentioning or inventing a new tome is insufficient grounds for us to want to accept it. And also there's that rule about, you know, it's not even a rule, but what Chekhov said about if a gun appears on stage, you better be fired before the end of the second act or something like that. Or why'd you have it? I don't know.
It's a sin to waste the reader's time.
Right.
Well, what's been the most frustrating thing that's that if you could say to every reader out there, I wish people would stop doing this, what would it be?
Other than the lack of salary?
Yeah, other than that.
Writing a ghost story and adding Cthulhu to it, and clearly you wrote this story for some other magazine and you're just trying to repurpose it, also doesn't get you any points.
Yeah, I've seen some that I can clearly see are themes from something else. Just tossing a different themed story at us, that's not fun, please don't. A pet peeve of mine is just following the rules of the submissions. I mean, but you can tell that to everyone and they'll still not follow them. We had pretty good luck with that, but it's annoying if things are, you know, not exactly what we asked for.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't have anything against erotica. I don't have anything against chop shop gore, per se. It's just not our thing. Okay? Doesn't seem to me like it would really fit with what we want. We're trying to go for cosmicism. And, you know, you're writing Rollick-type sex. It's just not.
You know, I was going to say that. It's a really great story, but, you know.
Not now.
Not now. I'll send it to Strange Eons.
Well, I just wanted to have you guys both on, and you're on every week, Matt, but just highlight the fact of that I appreciate you guys said to me, no, don't stop the magazine portion of the site. And, you know, because we want to do this. And let me just add that I'll remind you of that every time you bring up salary, Matt. but all kidding aside, I do really appreciate it. And I hope that the readers do too, because you guys are the reason why we're still able to do free Lovecraftian fiction. And when I started, you know, almost 6 years ago, the idea was a really great Lovecraftian or cosmic horror or weird fiction story that you might find in a collection that you have to go to Amazon or a bookstore and pay for to read that short story in that collection or that anthology, that same quality would be in this free magazine. And I think we've done a pretty good job of doing that. And for those that don't have the money to go out and buy a new anthology every time it comes out, you know, that's what we're here for.
Well, you know, Mike, building on that, I want to look at the people who just keep coming back, whether it be in the magazine or your other projects, and still play stories with you. You know, it's some of those names you can't get for a regular anthology, but you seem to have no problem recruiting them for the magazine.
Another thing I like is you've mentioned this and intimated it a number of times that you get the same old boys network, the same people get invited to anthology after anthology, and where's a new writer to get some stories to get their chops? I am very pleased that Alex thinks the same way, that we like reading new material, mm-hmm. and some people who publish, this is their first story ever in print.
Right.
Some really good people got rejected viciously and had to, like, go to Rainfall Books for their stories to get published, but that's...
Yeah, I was telling something similar to Mike the other day that I thought it was great that in this upcoming issue we have bigger names like Rollick, and then at the same time we had one that was a really good, well, I see you rolling your eyes. we have, you know, like a really good story that I really enjoyed, and the author had wrote back that he was so excited that it was his first publishing, and to have ones that, you know, everyone at least in this community recognizes next to people who are brand new writers who are excited about being published, I think is great. And to Matt's point and Mike's point, that's I think why the magazine has a good purpose in existing still.
Yeah.
Yeah. And thanks to all three of you for what you just said. I do think it's important to have a balance, to have people like Doug Wynn or Mike Griffin or Pete Rollick or in the last issue, John Langan and so on and so forth, in the magazine, and also it be a place, like Matt's told me several times, it continue to be a place where new writers can, if they've got a quality cosmic horror story can get their first break, you know, or for their first publication. So anyway, I just want to tell you guys both publicly how much I appreciate you, and to say that this magazine, this site, project, whatever you want to, it's a bunch of things now, is not all about me, and that there's people who are really making this work, and you guys are two of them. So thanks. So anyway, moving on.
I've got a little something I wanted to talk about.
Yeah, go right ahead.
Not really directly Lovecraftian, but it involves Joe Pulver, who is unfortunately not here. His latest edited anthology, The Madness of Caligari, coming out from Cadogan and Brammer. And for those of you who don't know, this movie is streaming live on Amazon currently. It's a very surreal movie if you've never seen it. It was made in Germany in 1920. And to get this print that they used on Netflix, they took the original negative that was available in Berlin in this film archive, and it was practically falling apart. And there were frames missing or scenes missing, and I think one reel was damaged. So they went all over Europe to find high-quality existing prints, and they used frames from those to make up the difference. And when you watch it, it's like they don't have like an actual scene of a village. It's a very surreal-looking suggestion of a village or suggestion of a room. And the thing that one of the things I found fascinating was, apparently, when they originally released it, it wasn't necessarily in black and white. It was in black and white, but the screens were colored. So, like, the one scene is yellow-tinged, indicating bright sunlight, or another scene is pink-tinged or blue-tinged. And they found two prints in South America that had the original coloring. So they added these colors to the print. And the music is not period music. It's music that they, I don't know if they wrote for it, but they had a lot of different people contribute. So the music is very, it's modern, but it's very, very appropriate to the mood the movie is trying to create. And the thing about this movie is reality is not what it seems. And the whole thing is a twist. So if that's the kind of thing you like, it's only, 80 minutes long at the most. It is well worth streaming if you've got Netflix. And then you can be prepared for the release of the anthology.
I love this movie. So are you saying that the Netflix version has a different soundtrack than what I saw at our little theater about 25 years ago?
It might. The thing is, this music doesn't... the way that they said the music, it's like the music credits came on after the movie had run, and now they're talking about people who contributed to the modern print. And they listed about 10 different composers. So I think that this is a music... because it was a silent movie. It didn't have a track. Do you know what I mean? So that might have been the kind of thing, it goes to your local movie theater, and they might have a live organist or a pianist or a combo providing music to the scene. So, yeah, I think that's exactly what I'm saying.
SP, did you have something to say?
Yeah, I just want to say I probably watched the film about 10 times. It's well worth screening. It's a great, great film. And this anthology is a big dream of Joe Pulver, and I really would love for everybody to grab a copy of it. The Madness of Dr. Caligari. It has stories. I have a story in it. Ramsey Campbell, Damian Walters, Robert Levy, Maura McHugh, Richard Gavin, Nathan Carson, Jeffrey Thomas, Nadia Bolton, Reggie Oliver, Cody Goodfellow, Mike Griffin, Daniel Mills, Molly Tanzer. It's just, I guarantee you this is going to be a wonderful anthology. So I'm very excited about it, and I'm really kind of humbled and honored to be a small part of it. I know Joe's been talking about this for a long time, working on it for a long time. It's a massive project. Dogan and Bremer is very excited. They're very proud of this anthology, so keep an eye out for it.
Yeah, it's out, let's see here, on Halloween, October the 31st, 2016. Fedogen and Bremer is the publisher, as SP said, I think, and you can get it, you can pre-order it at their website already, and I'm not sure if you can pre-order it at Amazon yet, but I do believe it will be out on Kindle. I think Dennis told me at Fedogen and Bremer. So, yeah, it looks insanely good, you know. Not just the...
what looks to be a really, really fine anthology. So.
Yeah.
Very excited about it.
I like it, actually, because this is kind of a little bit of a departure. Fedogen and Bremer had been financially strapped for a long time, and most of their anthologies they put out were directly Cthulhu mythos. And this is really just going into hardcore, into weird fiction. It's not Lovecraftian, so it's really nice to see them take that other step.
They did Scott Nicolay's collection, right?
Yes, they did.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And, you know, it's not Lovecraftian, but if you like cosmic horror, if you like weird fiction, this is a book you're really going to want to pick up. So, yeah, I can't wait to read it. Speaking of Joe Pulver also, this will be coming out this week. For those who are listening later, I'm holding up the reprint of Nightmare's Disciple. It'll be out in Kindle, too. So I'll probably do the matchbook program. So if you buy that Amazon has. So if you buy the print copy, then you can probably get the Kindle copy, for, I don't know, $1.99 or something.
Can I ask, Mike, did Joe edit this in any way? Like, what's the change? Has there been a change in the text? Like, did he?
On page 185, we changed a comma, I think. So, no, actually, there was a few things changed. The best person to ask that question would be Joe, and actually more than him, Kat. It's mainly just, you know, stuff that wasn't caught in the first edition so many years, 20 years ago now, something like that, when it was first printed.
I just thought if you took a chance to update the editing or whatever, you know.
Yeah, that has been done. If you're asking me, has the story changed, anything like that changed? No. So the neat thing that it does have that the first edition didn't have, when Chaosium published it, is there was not an introduction, is my understanding. Now, in the back, it sounds funny to put them in the back, but I decided to put them in the back. There's an unpublished introduction to the original 1999 edition by Robert M. Price. So if you've got Nightmare's Disciple, you bought it 20 years ago or since then, you won't have that. There's an afterword by Joseph S. Pulver Sr., 10 years plus after publication of this. That's from October 2010. And then an afterword by Robert M. Price, 15 years of Dark Discipleship. So a bit commentary on the book at different time periods, so that's kind of interesting. Yeah, let me put Pete on the screen. That's the Chaosium edition there. So if you've always said to yourself, self, my life would be complete if I could get this in a Kindle edition, then your life will now be complete, and you can also have the print edition here, which is updated with these, you know, afterwards and introductions. Not to mention, what do you call these things when you separate sections?
Chapters?
No, they're not called. I know it. Yeah. Not chapters, but, you know, that kind of thing. Instead of the three stars or whatever.
Breaks.
What?
Breaks.
Is that all it is? I was going to say breaks, but I thought there's got to be a word for this that isn't that.
There might be. I call them breaks.
None of us writers and editors know what it is, so we'll say it's breaks.
What? I think it's a colophon.
No. So we decided on breaks.
Colophon is a copyright page at the end of a book.
Anyway, one of my things is, as a publisher, when I've got my publisher hat on, is I like, instead of these breaks being something standard like 3 stars or whatever, or you know, anything that's standard, I like to take something from the book. Like in the Sea of Ash, it was a trilobite where those did those breaks, you know, a little trilobite. In this case, it's the symbol from the insane guy in the book. So, it's, anyway, kind of neat. So, if you're a polar fan, and I know there are thousands, if not millions, of them out there, you'll probably want this book. So there's that. That's coming out this week. Let's see, what else we got to talk about? Do we want to talk about that? Well, we got like 4 minutes left. We better do that next time.
I got one thing I want to say. There's a comic that came out from a Kickstarter project about Case File Arkham. It was a Detective Hank Flynn. It's actually a very entertaining read. They've got a Kickstarter going for the second volume of Case File Arkham. So you ought to take a look at it. I know not everyone's got money to spend on a Kickstarter, but the art is really good. The creators, Josh Finney and Patrick McAvoy, they did a great job on it. Well worth a look.
Well, then, speaking of Kickstarters, fundraisers, I'm echoing somewhere. We'll blame, I think it's Matt. It is Matt. Niels Hobbs is doing that H.P. Lovecraft Providence statue project. I won't dwell on this, but they're not, I don't think they're getting... they could use some more traffic. Let's put it that way. They do have some funds raised, but I guess this is a statue that they want to erect in Providence, statue of H.P. Lovecraft, with his cats, more importantly, with 2 cats. If you go to weirdprovidence.org/statue.html, or just probably Google the H.P. Lovecraft Providence statue project, you can check this out and decide if it's something that you would like to help make happen. So, I posted about, just as a topic for next week, maybe after we talk to our guest, there was an article at Wired.com titled Spinning Lovecraft into a Feminist Dream Quest. And it's, read you a couple words, fantasy author Kaige, I hope I'm saying this name right, Johnson. Sorry?
It's a her.
Yeah, I know, I'm sorry, I didn't mean his, I meant this name, right? Yeah, her name. Read the Dreamland stories as a child and remembers being entranced by them. When Johnson returned to the stories as an adult, she was troubled by the way that Lovecraft had handled his female characters. So if you want to get a lot of people losing their shit, and you have a website or a web page, have a Facebook page with, you know, 240,000 followers, just post this article, which is what I did a few days ago, and there was quite a lot of comments, quite a lot of commentary, and I had to delete and ban some people, but overall it kept somewhat civil, so maybe we'll cover that topic for next week. And I know SP, when I introduced that we were going to might talk about this today, you had some things to say about it too, so hopefully you can make it next week. But yeah, it's amazing how pissed off people get. So, all right. What was the prize again, Matt?
Prize is a copy of Dagon.
Dagon, hardcover comic, right?
Yeah, it's beautiful. This was a donation from an anonymous benefactor to the chat show.
Oh.
He wants it
for the talk show? Oh, well, tell them thank you from me. If you would like to win that, just send an email anytime between now and next Sunday. Today is August the 28th, 2016, to Lovecraft eZine Prizes at gmail.com. And put, I don't know, just put Dagon Comic in the subject of the email. And I'll use random.org to choose a winner next Sunday. So, all right, anything else we need to cover before I sign off, guys? Did we cover everything?
Just real quick, I just wanted to also mention that I'm going to have a story in Ravenwood Quarterly, which is a little startup quarterly that I'm trying to like to draw some attention for.
Sure.
And also I'll have an interview in Dark Discoveries this October, I think.
I've got a story in the first issue of Ravenwood Quarterly as well.
Oh, there you go. Me and Pete, we're TOC mates almost. I'm in the second issue, October issue.
And so does best-selling author Anthony Crowley. I just need to.
I knew you were going to go there. when's the first issue of Ravenwood come out then?
I don't know. It's a guy named Travis Neisler is doing it. I don't know, but they have a Facebook page where you can get all the info. It's Ravenwood. Okay. Just Google or search Ravenwood Quarterly and you'll hit it.
I think he got the first batch of from the printer to review on last week. So, okay.
Yeah, I've seen the cover for the first couple and they're gorgeous. They're knockouts.
Yeah. All right, well, Philip, thank you very, very much for being on the show and talking with us.
Thank you. It was a lot of fun.
And thanks, Kelly, for doing the interview. Really appreciate it. Great
thanks,
job.
Thanks, Kelly. Thank you, Kelly.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun for me.
And we will, let's see, I believe, I better not rely on my memory. Yes, Sam Cowan is the guest next week. So, great guy and doing a great job with his publishing company. So, we'll see everybody next week, and thanks for watching, and thanks for listening.